So, overview of what I'm going to talk about. A little bit about what the social web is, what the term means, what we mean by that. What W3C did in this space over the last almost 10 years. Tell a little story about an elephant. And then give a bunch of ideas for innovative things that I think people can do in this space that are pretty exciting. And then just to jump ahead in case you want to run outside, the conclusion is going to be that the social web is absolutely usable today, and that's a great place to build new things. So if you want to stick around for the details, please do. So what do we mean by the social web? So 10 years ago, The Economist did this story. Tim Berners-Lee then used it in his TED Talk. About how we've got all these silos, and there's all sorts of interesting social things going on, but people are locked into these silos, and that was a problem. So this is an old problem. I think everybody in the room probably is familiar with that. It's kind of hard not to be. But I want to go back a little bit earlier than that. Social software has been around for a long time. I couldn't find a picture of the first. This is Plato for everyone. I was using it in like 1979. So multi-user systems have been around for a long time, And the key thing about multi-user systems is that the value comes from the other users. It's not that the program is really doing anything for you itself. It's that it's connecting with other people. And that's pretty easy to build if you have a client-server approach or a database backend is a really common way to do it. And it's very common today. But it's at odds with the web's natural decentralized approach. Because if you build social features on one website, and then you build social features on another website, they're disconnected. You don't get the people from one appearing on the other. So what happens when people try to build social things on the web is the web ends up centralized. So quick list of popular websites that you've probably all heard of, and many of which you've probably used, all of these are centralized social systems. I mean, yeah, you've probably heard of all of these. Even at the end, like Wikipedia, GitHub, EasyChair, you know, pro-social things, they're still centralized. They still bring everybody together into one database because that's how you implement them. It's so hard not to. So we get very few things that are decentralized social. Things I could think of, emails by far the most popular, that works. IRC and XMPP are two other examples. There's a whole bunch of other things people have tried to do. There's a Wikipedia page listing like 50 or 60 decentralized social projects, basically all of which you've never heard of, because they didn't catch on. So why is it they don't catch on? What's so hard about this? One thing is that if you have a bunch of different systems talking together, they all have to speak the same protocol. So you need agreement of everyone who's implementing these systems. And that's hard. Anytime you want to add a feature or modify something, you need, again, agreement from everybody. So that's like practically impossible right there. Another problem is that you really only get modest financial reward. You're not going to control the world, then, you know, become the next billionaire. By building these things. So that it's hard to get venture capital, it's hard to fund the staff, you kind of have to do it as a labor of love usually, or find some interesting business niche. And the third is what I call the ghost town problem, which is because the value is from the other users, if you're the first user there, there's nobody else there, there's no value, it's empty, you go away. The next person comes along, there's nobody there, it's useless, they go away. So you need some way to bootstrap it, and it's very hard. And yet, still, there's a lot of value here, and a lot of people want this. You want the freedom to innovate in a way you can't really do with the silos. Users want autonomy, security, privacy. These are things that many of us have been aware of for decades. I think the mainstream world is becoming more and more aware of them even in the last couple weeks. So it's increasingly pressing. So is there a way we could do this on the web practically? One hint of an idea is that blogging, go back 15 years or so, was basically decentralized social. Everybody puts their own stuff on their own site, other people see it. Not very functional, but it was doing okay. So can we build on blogging and make the posts more data-like so that you can put a nice user interface in front of it? Allow immediate notification, some sort of pub-sub mechanism, do liking and commenting, which blogs centralized those back on the blog. You want to be able to do those on your own site and federate those somehow. You want access control for registered posts. So these are all things that blogging didn't have, but maybe we can sort of add these one at a time. And then, of course, you want to do applications beyond just newsfeed. You want lots of that list of things I had, Airbnb. That's not blogging. but that's a thing that you could maybe decentralize building out from this platform. So, part two of my talk, what did W3C do in the space? So starting in 2010, there was a Federated Social Web Summit in Portland, Oregon, got some people together. There was an incubator group coming out of that, then a community group. And finally, in 2014, we chartered a working group to try to see what we could do here. And that wrapped up in February of this year. So the working group brought together really three distinct communities. At least that's how it seemed to crystallize. There was what we might call the Indie Webcamp community, who were hardcore bloggers who thought the solution is to add metadata to their blogs, usually using microformats. Very enthusiastic. dozens of implementations of everything they did, but most of those implementations were only used by one person. They were not commercial. It was one particular style. There was the open social community, which was big companies doing mostly enterprise social and imagining it as these XML activity streams. It was a thing they did independently and then brought into this W3C process. And unfortunately, a lot of business plans have sort of a couple year time frame, so they were in there for the chartering of this and then didn't really participate. I think IBM was the only one of those who actually participated in the beginning of the group, and even they dropped out by the end of the group, because business horizons are challenging here. And the third was largely led by Tim Berners-Lee, this group called Solid Social Link Data. This is actually where I came into the group, was part of this. And there's very much everyone should have personal data stores full of RDF. And each of these camps had a very different approach to these, to the problem here. And then we had a bunch of meetings over the years. And this, I could tell you stories about each of these. You see, Tim sat in on this meeting. And the only two people, I think, in all of these meetings are me and Amy. Amy's down in the front row here, or second row here. But there were a number of people who participated in every one. They just were about for some of them, so they don't show up in these pictures. Went on over the years. Got a little silly sometimes. Finally, very serious as we're wrapping up in November of 2016. Actually, this was the day after the election, so we might have had extra reasons to be serious. Had a little debate about fake news and censorship. And we ended up with a raft of W3C recommendations. I'll say a little more in a minute about these are divided into basically those different camps. You would like in standards to bring all the camps together and have one standard that everybody can implement. We failed. We didn't do that. So we have these different pieces that work together to some degree, but also to some degree you might want to have to pick one style or the other. The Indie Webcamp style is very much, as I said, comes out of blogging tradition, so there's these, it's really independent pieces that help the web architecture. So the first one, WebSub, so this used to be known as PubSub Hubub. It's a way to do PubSub on the web. One website basically says to another website, tell me whenever this page changes, and you get notified of it. It's very simple, pretty simple, straightforward protocol. And you can see it's very useful for decentralized apps. Web mention is one website tells another website, I'm linking to you. You might want to know about that. Trackback was an early version of this. Web mention is the simplest recommendation I think I've ever seen at W3C. It's very straightforward. I'm basically, it's just doing a post there saying, by the way, I'm linking to you, and then has some bunch of security and performance considerations. Micropub is an API for posting to your own site, so you can have nice local clients where you author your thing and then it shows up on your blog without, so you get all the local adaptations, you know, taking photographs and all those things. So that's in the Indie Webcamp style. And there's a number of other things they've done that make that system all work nicely that didn't make it to recommendations. But if you look up Indie Webcamp stuff, you'll see that whole stack. The open social style, I said, came out of this XML enterprise style approach. As times change, it's not XML now, it's JSON and then JSON-LD. So it suddenly brought in the whole semantic web functionality, which was nice. I don't know how to get rid of that 48%.
Wait till it's 47%.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a performance of the computer.
Resisted that change.
It's gonna rain.
So, activity streams is basically a vocabulary for expressing things that you would do in a social context. You know, this person liked this post, this person made this post to this. And yeah, it's pretty long and complicated, but not that bad as recommendations go. ActivityPub adds to it and says how you like subscribe, how you do the data flowing between these streams. So ActivityPub sort of does many of the same things that WebSub and WebMention do in the other stack here. So you can build a whole system out of activity streams and ActivityPub. And then linked data notifications is a generalization of ActivityPub. There's one document called Social Web Protocols that Amy wrote that covers all these in detail and explains them all, at a high level. And then you can, of course, dig into each of these. And they all have test suites and implementation reports and all that. Next slide. Okay, we've lost focus. Okay. So just to say a little bit more about the multiple standards here, the bridge over the river here is really funny, right? It's got the same sort of multiple standard. There's two bridges tied together, but it fits in the same way. There's like this human scale bridge with stairs, which is kind of like the blogging style indie web camp. And then there's the one you can take a bicycle across that's more machine friendly, that's kind of more like activity streams. So it's a pretty nice analogy. So right as we were wrapping this up, I mentioned we finished about 2016, or we were just finishing up, and this thing happened called Mastodon. So there was this social, this decentralized social system that had an adoption curve that looked like this. And I don't know if you can read it, but it went from 300,000 users to 600,000 users in less than 2 weeks. And this is the point where we're just finalizing the spec. And that's an amazing adoption curve. And they weren't using our standard. This is not good. So we decided to delay the working group and coordinate with them. You know, can we get them to use ActivityPub? And maybe we're going to have to modify ActivityPub at the same time, right? We couldn't finalize it and then say, please use this, and they'd say, oh, but you don't do this thing we need. So we had to slow down, bring them on board, and amazingly, that was successful. The next release of Mastodon moved to ActivityPub, and suddenly we have a million ActivityPub users on this net, and so it was a huge win. And then a number of other folks in the space who are doing things kind of like this, and I've listed just some of them here, all decided, well, they at least want to interoperate with Mastodon and or do the W3C thing. So GNU Social and Pump.io, they still haven't quite released the new versions, but they definitely said they will. Pleroma is a new implementation that's potentially much, much more efficient than Mastodon. PeerTube is like a YouTube competitor that uses this as the federation protocol. Funquail is a music system that's using this. Nextcloud is kind of like, if you don't know Nextcloud, it's cool. It's a way to do all the cloud stuff yourself, and there's others here too. That amazing curve at the beginning, which would have beat Facebook in about 3 months had it continued, not surprisingly, didn't continue. So this is the graph of the last year, and you see that spike at the beginning is the thing I zoomed in on earlier, and it's gone to a much more modest adoption curve, but it's still coming up on 1.5 million. This is very noisy because it's really hard to measure the size of a federated system. There's thousands of different servers independently run. What kind of stats they're reporting varies. So that dip is not like the system went down. It's like the measurement system went down or had trouble for a little while. So at the beginning, I mentioned these three things that make starting federated social or decentralized social so hard. And so it was fascinating for me to see Mastodon beat that problem and sort of then dragged everyone else along or allowed everyone else to come along. And it's interesting how they did that. So just to say that, so it's a piece of free software, and you can install it on your own server, and about 2,500 servers are up and running that software right now, all interoperating. And the main social trick they did is that those servers are targeted at communities. So you can run one for yourself, but in many cases, someone said, I have this group of friends or this business or this community I'm a part of, let's all move at once together. The most bizarre and interesting one, a couple weeks ago, we had another group of about 50 or 60,000 people start up in one instance because there was a law passed in the US that made things bordering on prostitution illegal to do online. So suddenly sex workers of various sorts got kicked off of their online systems, and so somebody put up a Mastodon instance, not in the US, and you get suddenly 60,000 users who maybe communicated elsewhere all gravitate there at once. So there's now a bunch of interesting new content there. So some of this is embarrassing and hard to talk about, and there's some communities that are even more peripheral because, you know, the mainstream is mostly happy with the mainstream services. It's the more peripheral, interesting things that end up having to go elsewhere. And then other folks who just are motivated too. So each of these instances has local moderation rules, right? They don't have to follow the rules of whatever country you were in there. They can set up whatever country they want. They can have their own, you know, the thing a year ago, that was caused by a wave of people being frustrated by Nazis on Twitter. Basically, like, Twitter was feeling too abusive to them, so they wanted to leave and go to places that felt gentler, more safe. That was my understanding of what motivated most of those 600,000 at the start. And that all depends on local moderators who moderate their own instance. For an example, Amy and I put up an instance, w3c.social. It's open, you're all allowed to sign up there. Terms of service are basically W3C terms of service, although it's not officially associated with W3C. But Amy and I will enforce those and try to keep it a nice space. And if you haven't done that already, I suggest you do that after this talk and play around with it. Another thing, of course, that made Mastodon work is that it's really high quality software, and one fellow basically started it himself and then has managed hundreds of contributors and a massive system of people building it into really, really polished good software. And the thing that I think made the convergence of Mastodon and the Social Web Working Group work is that ActivityPub and ActivityStreams used JSON-LD, and I think it was a massive success for JSON-LD being comfortable to normal web developers. Right? This is a Ruby on Rails project. It's a very mainstream web development project. They didn't want to do anything weird and strange, and that's why they have hundreds of contributors. And JSON-LD doesn't feel weird and strange to them. It just feels like normal JSON. Even though to others of us who go, oh, this is semantic web. But they don't have to know that. They don't have to pay attention to that. It works just fine for them. So it's a massive endorsement of that. Okay, so the system is not exactly the same as you're used to with what I call the mainstream systems, the Twitters and the Facebooks. There's a bunch of things that's missing, which would be kind of interesting to add. And occasionally I think about pushing them, but interestingly, the community kind of pushes back on some of these. So you can't search the whole network. You could build a search engine, in theory, that could at least get the publicly accessible stuff. But there's not that much interest in that. There's a couple interesting ways to do search, but so it's interesting. Recommending who to follow, algorithmic feeds, obviously advertising. You might like that. Other people might not like that. So these are things that are missing. Groups and lists are actually going to come along very soon, I think. Website embedding, like buttons, or follow me on Twitter kind of buttons. There's a little bit of work on that. Trending topics and reliable metrics, my noisy slide earlier. Those would all be great things to have that the current centralized platforms have. I think they'd be good to have to catch up. But there's mixed feelings about that. And so this is some space for innovation, but maybe not the most exciting. So then I want to go into a list of ideas, about a dozen of things that I think are particularly cool that one could do now that we have this platform that's caught on. First one, privacy. So you can actually set these up as Tor nodes using Onion addresses, and now suddenly you have an extremely hard to monitor social network.
Because
I'm not sure if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but people who are exist interested in privacy and social abilities,
everybody who has their own website right now,
you can do feeds out of all the things you're doing that you want the world to know about. integrated into your own database. I mean, right now you can put those onto Twitter and put those onto Facebook and whatever you want, but you could go directly through these standard protocols. You can have feeds in, like aggregating news of related projects that you want to share. And these embedded buttons, like and follow, and other social interactions. You can put those on your current website right now. There's some work to be done to get that to work smoothly, but in some it's possible. Games and social go together really nicely. There was a point in Facebook's adoption, I think, where they used games as a key part, and then they sort of let that fall by the wayside, but I think a lot of people are still interested in those games. So there's probably a lot of possibility there. I don't know if you've noticed, but to me it seems like the social world is terribly fragmented now. Like, everyone I want to talk to, I have to think about what platform they're on and how to reach them. So integrating these together, having a standard lets us do that in theory. There's a system called Bridgy out there that does some of this right now. It's in Python open source. You could build on that as a start, or start your own. This has some of the Landrush quality, right? A million users sounds like a lot, but it's actually a tiny fraction of the web. So you can be a big fish in a small pond here, whether you're like a personality or a product. Now might be the time to invest and do something interesting there. And how to monetize this, right? Because it's an open platform, there's lots of possibilities, and we have to see what's going to work. Like, an obvious one would be some sort of pay to follow, and you kind of see this with Patreon right now, that people, you get to follow more closely, get more direct content, so that could all be implemented here. Or you could do native advertising, embedded ads, but you could be honest about it by having metadata on the posts that flag that information, and lots of other possibilities. User interface innovation. When's the last time the Facebook or Twitter UI changed? When you've got billions of users or hundreds of millions of users, you don't change the user interface willy-nilly. But in this space, Mastodon has, I think, 5 or 6 really production quality clients that let you use it, some native on various platforms, some web-based. I think they're all open source. So if you want to modify any of them, play around, or start your own from scratch, it's not that hard. If you're comfortable on those platforms, and unlike standing up your whole new social network, obviously you've already got the user base here. You just have to convince people to try out your UI. They don't need to lose their social network. It's pretty straightforward to try out something. I have 3 or 4 that I'm trying on Android at once, and I just sort of randomly click on the one I want to try today and see what they're like. So the possibility for user interface innovation and social is great. And one area of that, social readers. I know some people still fondly use their RSS readers, but they're missing a lot of social qualities. If they want to comment or like or share, kind of move outside the system, there's no access control. But you can do all of that on this platform. I linked to an example of where that's being done. That's using the Indie Web Stack right now that I know of. I think there's a lot of potential there to get people back to reading the way they want to be reading using these protocols. Get some of the really interesting questions about, bad behavior on the internet. We're more and more familiar with that now. And rather than saying it's up to Facebook to solve that problem, or it's up to Twitter to solve that problem, which, as large and smart and powerful as they may be, it's a really hard problem. This lets us innovate. It lets researchers try out different things, try different communities. This community level moderation may, in fact, simply be the key, but it might not. There's some really important research to be done on different approaches to handling bad behavior, and this lets us do that research in a way that would be hard to do otherwise. An example of that, what I call tunable feeds. The idea that, so right now these systems have one algorithmic feed that's a pretty good algorithm, but the user doesn't get to control it. I, as a user personally, would like to be able to pick, well, which algorithm do I want to use, which set of learning, of training behavior do I want to use, depending on the mood I'm in, the time of day, whatever. So let me tune feeds. Let me have my work feed and my, you know, brainless entertainment evening feed or whatever they are, or my I want to be outraged by news feed, and train those differently. So all the power of machine learning about this stuff, but under user control. That's the thing I personally really like to see. And the thing I'm actually working on now is how do you surface more credible content? How do you post things and annotate things in a way that helps readers find what is really trustworthy on there, on the internet? This is sort of the problem for our time. So if you're interested in joining me in this effort, you can go to credlab.org. It's another W3C effort that's just starting up. So a little pitch there. Extensibility, everything I've said sort of builds up from blogging, but we want a lot more than blogging. There's a lot of other decentralized apps. So how do you do that exactly? Activity Streams is RDF, so it's really easy to add whatever new data you want to it. But the community isn't really aware of that. The clients don't know what to do with that. Right now, the servers don't even know what to do with that. Pleroma has a schema-free database, but Mastodon has a schema-based database. So in fact, if you try to pass extensions through, they won't go through. So there's going to have to be some communication with the community about why you want to add extensions and how you want to carry them through. I think it's totally doable, but there's some interesting work to be done there. And then finally, like each of those areas, you know, group chat, obviously, we all like that. Photo sharing, ride sharing, meeting scheduling, buying and selling, job search. All these are things that would be pretty straightforward to build on this kind of platform in a decentralized way. And that would be pretty cool. Oh, now, here's the finally. Identity migration. Right now, we all have these fractured identities. We have, online, we have accounts in different places that connect with different people. This technology lets us coalesce those into one place. But then how do you pick one place? If you make your account on w3c.social, you're trusting me and Amy to run that responsibly, which we will, of course. But you would like to be able to someday decide to move it somewhere else. There's one commercial provider right now for, I think it's €3 a month. They'll run your service for you, but again, you're trusting on them. So how do you, and these are websites, of course. These are all web protocols, so you've got URLs. You want the URLs to move when you move. You want your trust to move when you move. I think this is all pretty exciting set of problems. I know how to solve them all, but nobody believes me. So another fun thing. Okay, so that's basically my pitch. I'm definitely interested in questions. I have some links here. There is a community group, the Social CG at W3C, you can join. They meet every other week to chat about this stuff. I strongly suggest you make an account on some server and try this out. As I say, W3C.social is open to try, but there's lots of others. The specification that gives you the highest level view of this is social-web-protocols. And again, these slides are online for all the links. So, questions?
Yay. Thank you, Sarah. Questions? Oh, wow.